Last week I have explained how SAEM works. Today I will cover some of the settings of this algorithm. The settings can be accessed via this button here, and the first setting I would like to tell you about is the simulated annealing. It has already been presented in the feature of the week number 44, and I strongly encourage you to watch it. As a brief reminder, the simulated annealing prevents the omega parameters and the error model parameters to decrease too fast. I would like to show you what happens for a one compartment model with oral absorption and linear elimination parameterized with Ka, V, and K. In one case, I will fix the omegas to a quite high value, 0.4, and in the other case, I fix them to a small value, such that you can see the impact of high versus low omega values. In this plot, the color map represents the objective function value for this model, depending on the value of Ka and K, and also V, but I can only plot in two dimensions. We can see that for this model, I have a local maximum here and the global maximum likelihood here. The black dot represents my initial values. For the first step of the SAEM iteration, we sample the individual parameters from the conditional distribution. This conditional distribution is proportional to these two terms. This part here represents the information provided by the data, and this part can be seen as a prior provided by the population parameters at the previous iteration. A large omega value is equivalent to a weak prior, so the individual parameters that are sampled, that we see here with gray stars, are influenced a lot by the data and not so much by the population parameters of the previous iteration. So this means that we can do big steps in the parameter space. On the opposite, if omega is small, the prior is strong and the individual parameters will stay close to the population parameters of the previous iteration. If we look at the entire SAEM procedure, we see that with small omegas, we move more slowly, but also with less noise compared to the case with large omegas. What is very interesting in this example is that with large omegas, the model first converges to the local maximum, but is then able to escape it to find the global likelihood maximum. When the omegas are small, this is not the case because there is not enough noise to jump by chance out of the local maximum. So the simulated annealing option allows you to keep the omegas high at the beginning to better explore the parameter space before letting the omegas converge to their correct value. However, the simulated annealing can also have drawbacks. I invite you to watch a video dedicated on the simulated annealing to learn more about it. The next setting I would like to explain is the step size exponent. At the second step of each SAEM iteration, we calculate the new population parameters from the sampled individual parameters. The formula used for the exploratory phase is this one, and the one for the smoothing phase is this one. But in fact, we can rewrite those two formulas as this one here, where I have added the alpha. If alpha is equal to 0, then this is 1. The two thetas cancel out and I recover this formula here. And on the opposite, if alpha is equal to 1, I recover this formula here. This alpha is the step size exponent. It can be seen as the memory of SAEM. When it's equal to 0, I have no memory at all and my new population parameters depend only on the individual parameters. That's important for the exploratory phase, to be able to move far away from the starting point. For the smoothing phase, alpha must be between 0.5 and 1, otherwise the algorithm cannot converge. We have done a lot of tests and found that alpha equals 0.7 is the value that allows the fastest convergence. And that's the value that is set by default in monolix. The last setting is related to the Markov chain Monte Carlo procedure that is used to sample the individual parameters. As this procedure is used not only for SAEM, the settings is not here, but in settings, project settings. It's the number of chains here. The number of chains permits to increase artificially the number of individuals by replicating the dataset, exactly as if you would copy-paste the data several times. Let's assume I have 50 individuals in my original dataset. If I have one chain, I will sample 50 individual parameter values and average over those 50 values to get the new population parameters. If instead I set 10 chains, then I have the equivalent of 500 individuals, so my average is over more values and is then more stable. If we look at the entire SAEM algorithm, we see that with more chain, there is less noise, we are more stable. This is good, but it of course comes to a price. With 10 chains, each iteration is 10 times longer than with one chain, so there is a balance to find. By default, in monoliths, we set the number of chains in order to have the equivalent of at least 50 individuals, because from our experience, that's the number required to have a trajectory that is stable enough and still pretty fast. For large datasets with more than 50 individuals, the number of chains is 1, and for a dataset with 10 individuals, for instance, then the number of chains would be set to 5 by default. Increasing the number of chains can help convergence in some cases, for instance, if you have a correlation term that goes to 1 or minus 1. But as I said, it will take longer to run. That's it for today. Have a nice week.